Hey, Julie. Happy
Hi.
New Year.
Hi, Val. Happy New Year.
I'm really excited about starting this knowledge series. What are we going to talk about today?
I am too. Today, I was hoping that you could talk to us a little bit about how customer experience design and journey mapping drives ROI for our partners and clients.
Oh, what a great subject. I like making more money. Gosh. Well, I find a lot of clients don't think about return on investment or the money that's going to be made as a result of better customer experience. Oftentimes, they actually even think that ROI for CX has separate drivers from the rest of the business. But on the contrary, what we've always found is CX ties directly to the same drivers as revenue and profit, acquisition, retention, growth. We call that macro CX, the big picture. So the beauty of CX is that it impacts the more granular day-to-day revenue-producing activities that we call micro CX. So those things are communications, campaigns, user experience on your website, and perhaps your mobile apps. All of those affect the bottom line. So if you can track what you're doing in both macro and micro customer experience work, generally you have a lot of financial options to choose from. There are targeted customer experience metrics like customer effort, net promoter score, and quantifications that you can have, such as top and bottom box for voice of the customer. Most of these tend to be more directional, though they may be tied to satisfaction and dissatisfaction. And then they factor into things like for the velocity of a purchase or retention calculations that are still newer and not as well tried. But if you again fall back on some things like customer experience and customer relationship management benefits, they all work.
That's awesome. Do you have any examples of any times when you've used this successfully with any of your recent clients that you'd be willing to share with us and tell us about?
Sure, let's talk about a couple of them. This particular client here was a large weight loss clinic, something like one of the ones that you see that people spend $1,500 a month on. And that was something that they were rapidly growing. So we're going to talk first about the macro experience. First, what they did is they started growing and they grew really, really fast, hired a lot of people, opened up a lot of stores, and then suddenly their revenue started trailing off and their referrals started decreasing. So what we did was look at their client base. The first thing we did was a statistical segmentation where they identified their best customers. Those happened to be working women, heavily traveled women, who got around and were rarely at home, and entertaining couples. So that data told us that they were having trouble retaining these two groups, and they didn't really understand why. So that affected both their operational cash flow as well as their referrals, and the referrals were their cheapest way of getting new clients. And it also affected their ongoing revenue because as people fell out of the program early, they stopped getting total cash flow from an entire program. So we mapped both groups, and using data around their behavior and their qualitative and quantitative research, voice of the customer and voice of the employee, we found different reasons why each of those groups were dropping out of the program. So by fixing those pain points, they resulted in swinging back within 3 months to their original growth trajectory.
Wow, that is an awesome success story. So it sounds like that was a good example of a macro. Do you have any good examples of a micro case study?
Of course, we do. So we work with a large hospitality group with over 28 different companies and properties, where they were looking to understand their customer base more completely and then to figure out how to increase their overall revenue. They knew there was something in it, but they weren't really sure how they would change from their current state and get to something more productive across all the different companies. So, thinking that we might find some commonalities, we stepped back and again consolidated their key customer data first. And then we looked at their most valuable customers. And interestingly enough, we found that there were a lot of similarities across the companies that no one had ever recognized before. So we took this and we started mapping some very high-level customer experiences around what these customers valued, what their needs were when they were on vacations or on business trips, and then how they went about looking at all the different options they had to choose from. And though it was tough, it took a few cruises and some trips testing out their different products and services, we mapped that experience from plan through rebooking.
That sounds so, like a really fun project and a lot of really tough work, especially the travel.
Oh yeah. Wine tasting in Portugal and cruising in Costa Rica.
Terrible.
I know. We suffered through it. So we were able to apply that directly to cross-sell different experiences and vacations. They started doing some joint trips, and within 6 months, they'd seen a 5% jump in overall revenue. So then they started taking that money and applying some of that information and playing around some campaigns. And within a year, they had added 10% in new revenue on $500 million bottom line. So that was a pretty exciting thing.
Absolutely. This is very impressive. One question that I have coming off of that is, how do we demonstrate and explain this type of ROI generating opportunity and analysis when maybe a company doesn't have the time or the appetite or the understanding for how we could move them forward through a customer experience project?
Yep, we hear this a lot. That's a great question. I love turning the light bulb on for this type of client. One of the ways you can do that is looking at something they're planning. This example here is around digital transformation. So say they've got a new product, or they're going after a new market, or they're trying to transform some of the ways that they do business today. That's a really interesting thing. Right now, targeting mobile millennials is a really big thing. And many times what we find is the operations, technology, and marketing teams don't think about the fact that this segment might be very different from their current users. So what we help them do is an agile project. This example here is one of those, where you look at the path to purchase and the triggers for both types of users to help them understand both opportunity and cost. So we did this for a regional bank. And the first thing that we did was this very agile map here, where we showed what types of communications a millennial might be interested in, and what type of communication a boomer, or I heard a new term this week, a perennial, might take. And when you look at these, their expectations are very different. So oftentimes, this just simple map is a very good way of helping people understand the gap between what they have today and what they don't. Then the next thing that you might want to do is dig a little deeper. So for a regional bank company interested in expanding their reach by moving into online banking, which is very popular today. So that's no ATMs, no branches, it's all online. And they had a primary base of older and more traditional channel users. So getting new and younger customers was important for their long-term success. So we suggested that they take a cue from their competitors and understand what they needed to do for what we'd call table stakes and what best in class experiences were. We put together an outside in research project where we looked at how their competitors were addressing online banking using several personas: Molly Millennial, Jack and Jill Omnichannel, and their current Samantha Senior, who uses teller branch and call centers. What we added, we pulled in their operations and policies and technologies to look at what they had in place today as compared to what they needed. So Molly Millennial was expecting a mobile app and chat and all digital. What they started seeing is wide gaps between how they were attracted, serviced, and managed customers today and strategically where they needed to go in the future. They ended up putting the work on hold until they rectified a number of big structural and compliance issues that would have killed interest for their all digital crowd.
Oh, that's super awesome. So you saved them from a major investment that would not have properly served all their segments. Very cool. That led me to another thought, another question. Are there times when you feel it's more profitable for a company to just do a better job of serving their existing segments as opposed to trying to move into a whole new market or a new segment altogether? And do you have any examples of that?
Exactly. And this is oftentimes your best customer. This is the best use of funds short term, is really understanding what micro CX can do for you. So we had a large retail client who actually came in and they called us in, and we walked into this wall where they had sticky notes on their entire wall, and they laughingly called it their wall of shame. So they knew that they were over touching and not necessarily touching their clients in the right message at the right time, but they really didn't know how to quantify that and to understand what they should be doing differently. So they understood the basics of what they needed to do. So what we did first is we rendered their wall into Suite CX to get some statistics. And then we started looking at things like number of touches per week, number of touches that they could actually track, the moments of truth, conversions, unsubscribes, and everything that they were doing for two different brands. And once we applied their wealth of information that they already had around campaigns that they were doing, it was kind of interesting. One of the first things we noticed is that they didn't track by touch. They tracked by rolling campaign, which is very typical in the marketing automation world. So we had to interpolate some of their tracking and data from different channels to get a moment in time view where we could kind of freeze things and look at what they were doing and how that was affecting them. So once we did that, we were able to look at their critical path and the common path to understand what touches they were doing to different people, whether they were over or under touching them as they went through the cycle. And they found that they were overusing some channels, email, which again is very typical, and underusing others, social media. So they didn't quite know how to deal with the in-store sales and channel and how to integrate that into the process. And that came out as well. So that's where the crossover from CX to UX comes here, right? So we've got a communications channel. And if you can improve your eliminate your extraneous touches, either online or offline, that cost you a lot of money as you go through, you can save money while you're making more because people are going to stick with you longer and you can quickly get to a better ROI number. So we shared this information with the in-store sales team, helped them understand how to deal with the different segments that were coming in because they had very different spend segments. People that they were competing with that were Nordstrom's buyers and people who just needed to rent a tux for a weekend. They even stopped offering customers to some of their customers because they found that when they looked at the data, these customers weren't actually using the coupons and they were spending more money on doing that activity than they were making. So now they do a much more streamlined communications touch, down from about 94 to 20 touches, and they are improving their overall metrics as well as saving money.
Wow. So it sounds like the bottom line is customer experience analysis and journey mapping can really impact your ROI.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much, Valerie, for sharing today. And I look forward to doing another one of these with you.
Likewise. Have a great one.
Thank you.
Let's talk again soon.